Travelling Monsters Publishing House presents Peter Green and the Unliving Academy. This book is full of dead people. The Unliving Chronicles, Book 1. Written by Angelina Allsop. Narration and original music by Greg Patmore. To Jared Allsop, who inspired me to go for my dream. Chapter 1. Hello. You're dead. Please, wait in line. 14-year-old Peter Green woke up knowing only three things. The proper way to put on a tie, lemon custard was disgusting, and he was dead. Sure, he knew a few other things like, you know, math and history. Well, some history, just not his own. He knew his age, but he couldn't tell you anything about his last few birthdays. He couldn't tell you how he died. It was like he'd been reset to factory mode, left a blank screen, with no personal data whatsoever. Pete blinked groggily. Where am I? He winced as a bright white light shone through the blurry haze in his eyes. Slowly, color entered his vision, and noises filtered through the nothingness. Voices and movements were all around him. It sounded as though he were surrounded by a bustling crowd of people. He blinked some more, and his eyes finally focused enough for him to see the bright white light was a chandelier. He sat up slowly, expecting pain, but finding none. He looked around, never more confused in his life or afterlife. He seemed to be lying in the middle of a rather busy lobby. The building was grand, nearly every inch of it covered in gleaming marble. From the corner of his eye, he noticed a woman in a pretty red dress bending down towards him. Pete turned towards her, smiling, and then yelled, "What the?" It wasn't a woman, but a squat, ugly man with long red hair pulled back in a ponytail, wearing a sour expression.
"With the wet?"
the man asked, with a heavy Scottish accent. He pulled a little at his white security T-shirt that was tucked into a navy blue kilt. The man had a large scar that ran from across the top of his skull down over one eye and mouth to just above his jawline. No. It wasn't a scar. It was an open wound.
"Are you okay?"
Pete asked, pointing a shaky finger at the man's face. The man looked affronted.
"Nah, son. I'm near all right. Come on, didn't you just lie there?"
he said, and poked Pete with his security baton. His red ponytail swung as he pointed to the bustling crowd.
"Can't you see how forstowed it is today?"
He looked at his watch.
"'Tis rush hour, 9:15, and we hae a train crash and an earthquake, and you're just lying there like tis your kip."
"My what?"
"Your kip."
He rolled his eyes and said,
"Your bed."
Pete blinked and patted the floor. It definitely wasn't his bed. An image of grass flashed into his mind, but the next moment, it was just the gleaming marble again. He rubbed his eyes and tried remembering how he'd gotten here. But another sharp poke and a yell from the angry guard interrupted his thoughts.
"I'm dead," Pete said blankly.
The security guard gave him a, "Well, duh," look and pulled him by the scruff of his neck.
"Well, obviously. How come do you think you're here?"
He didn't wait for Pete to answer and asked, as he looked around,
"You hear we anyone?"
Again the man answered his question before Pete could even open his mouth.
"Aye, of course not,"
he said, rolling his eyes and pointing down a hall.
"Listen, you donder down there, fill out the form, then they'll take you where you need to be, okay?"
Pete turned to the man and looked him in the eye.
Thanks. Thank you, Angus. The guard looked taken aback. He touched the white badge sewn onto his white security shirt. "Nay problem," he replied, slowly. Pete opened his mouth to ask why he couldn't remember anything, but the guard had already moved on to yell at another confused man who had been sleeping in the middle of a busy lobby floor. With a sigh, Pete looked back up at the chandelier and painted ceiling, and then around at the massive circular room he was in. It was about the size of a football stadium and was surrounded by marble archways leading to different places. On one end, an archway led to a wide path to the West Track subway. The opposite led to the East Side tracks. There were signs for portal stations 1 to 30 to his left, and to his right were stations 31 to 40. He headed towards the archway the man had pointed to, with a sign that said, "Government Services." As he walked, he mindlessly straightened his tie and smoothed his shirt, and was shocked to find it untucked.
"Wait a second."
He faltered and stopped walking. A woman bumped into him and cursed at him. He tried to apologize, but couldn't quite make his voice work. Frankly, he was at a loss for words. He looked down, mouth open, at his outfit. He was shoeless and dressed in striped blue pajamas with an expensive cream-coloured Battistoni silk dinner tie, tied in a four-in-hand knot. Not exactly the usual clothes he'd pick from his closet, at least as far as he could remember. A tie and pajamas. Even in reset mode, he knew that was an odd combination. He touched the tie in wonder. What could he have possibly been doing when he died? A sharp bump to his shoulder shook him from his thoughts. He looked up to see a man in an expensive business suit brush by him. The man was loudly complaining as he wove through the crowd.
"Might miss my port. Why do people choose rush hour to die?"
Pete looked around and noticed that he had attracted the attention of another guard. Before the guard made his way over to start yelling at him, Pete quickly started walking away. Several paces away, he paused at the back of the line he had been directed to, and sighed. It was almost as long as a line at Disneyland. The man in front of Pete saw him looking around and sniffed.
"We picked a good time to die, huh?" he said dryly. The man's cheap brown suit had dark splatters on it that had to be blood. He wore a brown hat that, when he lifted it to scratch his head, revealed a fist-sized hole in the man's head. "Just like the people at Purgatory to design the DRD like the DMV. Life's slowest bureaucracy. I know this is a small town and all," he added angrily, "but this is a pretty big port station. They should invest in making it bigger, or," he added loudly, "they could separate the DRD from the insanely busy portal station."
As though this should be obvious. He got several nods and amens to this from people around him. He shook his head.
"No other port is set up this way."
He turned to Pete and added,
"I mean, look at this." He pointed at the line in front of them. "This is just the line to get the ticket to wait in the real line."
"Oh," said Pete, flabbergasted. The man chuckled.
"That's how things are done in Purgatory. There are lines to wait in more lines."
He hailed a boy shouting on the corner, a stack of newspapers bound at his feet. The boy grabbed the stack and ran over and gave one of the papers to the man, who tossed him some coins in return.
"Soon as my paperwork is in and I get my new ID, the man said, "I'm out of here."
Vaguely, Pete wondered where the man had gotten money from, but he asked instead,
"Where are you going?"
The kid ran back over to his corner.
"Paper!"
he started back up.
"Get your paper!"
"Got some family up north," the man said to Pete. "I'll stop there first." He shook open his newspaper.
"Then I'm not sure. I'll look for work and see how that goes."
He lowered his head and became engrossed in an article, leaving Pete to contemplate his words. Pete looked around. By now he'd gathered that he was in a transportation building, set up like a train station. As the line moved forward, Pete could see from a different angle that there was a ticker hanging from the roof that was constantly changing. He could hear the clatter of the letters and numbers as they changed. Demonton to Purgatory, it read. Arrival 10:10. Then the sign switched to say, Purgatory to Valhalla, non-stop. Departing 11:15. This clattered away to say, Purgatory to North Pole, 9:30. Delayed to 10:32. And on, and on. He watched people rushing to work, whatever work in this world meant, carrying briefcases or purses. Occasionally, a voice would come on over a loudspeaker, announcing arrivals and departures. A chorus of moans met the announcement that Portal 32 was closed due to technical difficulties. When the line moved again, he could finally read the label printed on the glass doors, Department of Registered Deaths. A few more minutes, and the line pushed him through the doors into the busy room beyond. There were about 5 people in front of him now. When he looked closer at the lady at the counter handing out the tickets, he suppressed a gasp. The woman behind the counter of the line they were waiting at was a skeleton. Pete would have actually mistaken her for some sort of decoration had she not been arguing with a large man in a trench coat in front of her desk.
Everyone gets a ticket. Everyone goes in line, she said, with a heavy Jersey accent. I don't care who you were. Here, you're just dead, and you get in line.
She did not seem angry, almost a little bored, in fact, and shooed the man away, who was fuming in front of her. She pulled a box of cigarettes out of the breast pocket of her dress and tapped it on top of her desk with her left hand as she gestured lazily at the next person in her line. The cries from 2 small babies held by the anxious mother before the counter made the skeleton lady turn her head slightly. Pete was surprised that she was wearing lipstick, cat-eyed glasses and earrings. She wore the blonde hair attached to her skull in a bob, common in the 50s. She nodded at the woman and sucked in a puff of smoke. Having no lungs to fill, the smoke escaped her ribcage and into her dress, making it look like it was on fire. After about 5 minutes, Pete stepped up to the counter and smiled at the skeleton. He wasn't sure if she smiled back, but her body language seemed a little friendlier.
Good morning. I just died. Alone?
She asked, and when Pete just looked at her, she repeated, Did you die alone?
Yes, he said. I believe so. And are you meeting someone here?
Pete frowned.
I don't know. And do you have your memories?
No, he said, relieved that this was a common enough thing for her to ask.
You will want 1A-19.
Pete stared blankly and she tapped her pen impatiently right in front of him.
The form on the wall.
Pete looked down while she typed a couple of things. Along the wall of her counter were forms, resting in clear plastic shelves, labelled A19-2-93, Incidents Only. Form 14-2-B, T-H-E-R-N. Form 97, Parents, Children Present, T-H-E-R-N. Location Form P-119, Parents, Children Previously Deceased. And finally, 1A-19, Children 18 and Under. She finished typing, and a ticket came out of a small machine with a number on it.
Take the ticket and your form, fill it out, and they will call your number.
She nodded at him, and Pete knew he was being dismissed. He thanked her and looked around for a vacant seat. The large room was filled with rows of occupied chairs and a line of booths, each with an attendant behind a window, talking to a mangled or bloodied person, holding documents of some sort or another. Pete found an empty chair next to a smiling woman with a missing eye. He was feeling nervous, and there was an annoying tingling in his skin, as though he were forgetting something important. He couldn't help but feel that though he seemed to be in the right place and doing the right things, that there was something very wrong. Rubbing at the goosebumps on his arms, he looked down at the paper in his hands. The printed instructions read, "Fill out the information below as completely as you can. Please use a black or blue pen. Illegible forms will not be accepted. Please ask an attendant for help if you are missing your arms or if your hands are unusable." Pete frowned and began filling out the form. It didn't take long, as it only asked for a few things. Name, last and first. Middle initials, optional. Age. Date of birth. Date of death. Place of birth. Place of death. When he finished answering the first three questions and staring blankly at the next four, Pete didn't know what to do to pass the time, so he began looking around again. Along the walls were signs that said things like, "Black or blue pen only. Documents signed in blood will not be accepted." Another sign cheerfully said, "Ask one of our friendly attendants about working in a government position. Great benefits, great pay." A picture of a smiling thing was depicted on the poster. She was wearing a white blouse and her head was shaped much like an anteater, and she had similar skin tone. She wore lipstick and had brown hair sprouting from the top of her scalp. It was pinned to the side in an attempt at an elegant side bun. Pete kicked his feet nervously and looked up absently at the screen and jumped when he saw his number was flashing. He jolted out of his seat, almost dropping his paper, and walked to his window to find an impatient-looking young woman behind the window. The young attendant looked to be in her early 20s and had dark blue eyes, sandy blonde-coloured hair, a dimpled chin, and a large forehead covered by bangs. She wore only a small amount of makeup. He slid his papers through the slit in the window, nervously smoothing his tie. He could smell her perfume through the glass window. She pursed her lips and picked up the paper, squinted at it for a second, and said into the microphone,
"This is all you remember?"
"I'm missing my brown shoes," he responded. Without thinking, he cringed. Where had that come from?
Instead of rolling her eyes, she simply wrote it down on the paper. She then turned to her computer and began typing again. She paused and used her mouse to click several things before turning back to him.
"You can keep a copy of this for your records."
She pulled off a carbon copy of the form. As an old printer chugged something out, she stopped what she was doing to put on some chapstick. The woman clicked her mouse a couple of times and then took his form and turned to a printer that was chugging out a document.
"Looks like you're from New York,"
she said, looking at his paper. Her eyes flicked up to him.
"Funny you don't have an accent."
She quickly pulled the paper out of the printer, tore it expertly apart at the perforated edges, and stapled one half to his copy of the forms. She then pulled out a map.
"How do you know that?" Pete asked. "Why can't I remember anything?"
"You'll pick up the rest of your memories later," she said shortly. "When you're 18, I wasn't supposed to even tell you where you were from."
Pick up his memories? He wanted to ask her more, but her tone and the look she gave him made it clear that the subject was closed.
"You are close to where you need to be,"
she said, unfolding the map and placing it down in front of her, facing him. She pulled out a pen and circled a building. Then she pointed at it with her pen, listing out the directions turn by turn.
"You'll exit here and wait at the bus stop for the 119 line,"
she said.
"Then, when you get off, you just walk down the dirt road. You can't miss it."
She passed the carbon copy with the printed paper stapled to a single ride bus pass, along with the map, through an opening in the bottom of the glass divider.
"Can't miss what?"
Pete asked, looking at the map.
"Where am I going? What do I do now that I'm dead?"
was he supposed to haunt this place circled on his map? The girl squinted at him, like she thought he might be acting dense on purpose. She chewed her gum and said,
"You go to school, of course."
School, he thought miserably, as he walked outside. Of course. Here he'd thought he might get to do something cool in the afterlife. Nope, just as lame as life. He frowned again. He really wished he had his memories, and wondered again where you picked up your memories from. What did they look like? Oddly enough, he still had that prickle in his skin that this was somehow wrong. Like he truly was supposed to remember something important. Something he needed to know now, not when he was older.
Maybe it's just supposed to feel this way,
he reasoned, as he passed a walkway by a green area with benches, with a sigh.
Maybe everyone feels this way when they die.
But unfortunately for Pete, it was his first instinct that would prove to be right. Chapter 2. Please, don't feed the dodo birds. Pete double-checked the number scribbled on his map, verified he was in the right place, and sat down at the bus stop. He looked around, watching the people strolling by and the cars milling down the street. The tranquility outside was at odds with the hustle and bustle inside the government transit building. He found he really enjoyed the quiet. He glanced down at the map and frowned, reading one of the ads printed on the side. Welcome to Purgatory. Your next memorable family vacation is here. The soft squeal of brakes and the hiss of pistons made him lift his head, tensing. A bus was turning onto his street, heading towards him. When he saw the number 331 above the windshield, he relaxed. Several people holding suitcases exited the bus and hurried towards the building he had just recently vacated. Pete stood up, suddenly feeling too wired to sit on the bench. The shock of everything had worn off, and his nerves were really kicking in now. What was his new school going to be like? All of a sudden, behind him came a blood-curdling scream. Pete leapt about a foot in the air and spun around, looking wildly for what had made that noise. A woman was bending over, tending to her toddler, and a couple of people were strolling in the distance, but it seemed no one else had heard the scream. Some fat, oversized birds hopped lazily about, pecking at the grass. They hadn't even been startled.
"What is going on?"
Pete wondered out loud, as he looked all around.
Am I hearing things now?
He was breathing heavily. A scary thought came to him.
Did I go mad when I died?
He bit his lip, worried. He nearly jumped out of his skin when he heard the scream again.
What the?
He screeched. Now he knew he'd not been imagining it. It had been a bird who had screamed. The woman tending to her son looked up casually in his direction, and then turned away. Pete stared at the birds, and one of the birds looked curiously back at him, tilting its head sideways. The bird let out another small scream. The sound grated on his nerves like nails on a chalkboard. He huffed,
"Man, that is annoying."
"Tell me about it,"
a gravelly voice came from behind him. Pete turned to see an elderly couple by the bench. The woman raised a hand, holding a handbag, as she sat down.
"Shoo! Shoo!"
she said in a feeble voice. The birds ignored her, staring at Pete. There were more of them now, and they all started hopping towards him, hopefully, letting out shrill shrieks as they went.
"Don't feed them,"
the man warned, tucking a newspaper and umbrella under his arm and sitting next to his wife.
"Those darn dodo birds will follow you around till your second death,"
he harrumphed again.
"No wonder they went extinct. Our problem now, darn pests,"
he grumbled. Before Pete could ask him about the birds, the old man let out a howl of rage. Pete jumped back in surprise, and the birds screamed in protest, fluttering their wings and running away in wild, zigzagging motion. The man pointed in rage at a bus making its way to them. The bus stopped, brakes squealing and pistons sighing. The door opened, and the man laid into the driver.
"You are 4 minutes early. If I were on time, you'd already be gone. I can't miss my doctor's appointment."
"I ain't early,"
the bus driver yelled back.
"Your watch is slow. Fix your watch."
"If my husband wasn't early,"
his wife yelled in her quavery voice,
"he would have missed his back appointment. Shame on you."
She pointed her walker at him as she made her way onto the bus.
"Shame."
Pete climbed in, feeling amused, behind the couple, and handed his token to the driver, who nodded to him. Pete stood there, and the driver raised his eyebrows.
How do I know when to get off?"
he asked, hesitantly.
"You a newbie then?"
the driver said. Pete nodded.
"All right, I'll tell you when to get off. Where are you headed?"
Pete showed him the paper, and he nodded.
"Oh, and now we're gonna be late,"
the old man yelled.
"All 'cause he dunno where he's going."
"Stop your complaining, Henry,"
the bus driver yelled back.
"He has a back appointment to go to,"
Henry's wife repeated. Pete made his way to a seat, tuning out the argument that had sparked back up. The drive became infinitely more enjoyable when Henry and his wife exited at the very next stop.
"Why didn't they just walk?"
he wondered, as he watched them hobble to Henry's back appointment. As the bus rode onward, Pete looked out at the clean brick buildings they passed by in the beautiful town. Cheerful billboards were painted with bright, happy yet muted colours. Passengers got on and off, and there was a cheerful banter among them all. Everyone on the bus seemed to know one another. Pete smiled politely and nodded his head at two women dressed identically, except for the colour of their outfits. They were looking at him beadily under their Sunday hats, but after Pete smiled, they relaxed and smiled back. He noticed that one loosened her gloved grip on her pink handbag, and soon the pair was gossiping about their neighbour and a boy named Jim. Pete looked at their dresses and then down at his shoeless feet and sighed. He hoped they would have clothes for him at the school. He sincerely hoped he was not going to be stuck in pinstripe pajamas for the rest of his death. They drove past a sign that read, "Thanks for visiting Town Square." The tall buildings gave way to smaller, charming little shops, and then to white picket-fenced neighborhoods. One by one, the bus lost all of its passengers, save Pete. After about 10 minutes, the bus driver pulled to another stop. The driver looked back and said,
"This is your stop, son."
Pete looked at him, startled. There wasn't a school in sight. The driver seemed to know what he was thinking. He nodded his head, hand still on the lever for the open door.
"Just walk down the dirt road for a few minutes, and it's on your right."
The driver looked less friendly now, and more impatient and guarded. Pete thanked him and walked out. The door shut not one half second after he stepped off, and the bus sped off before he cleared the street. A rock kicked up and hit him on the leg.
"Ouch,"
he said, rubbing his leg and looking at the retreating bus curiously.
"What was all that about?"
He turned and swallowed, suddenly understanding why the bus driver had been so keen to leave. Goosebumps rose on his arms and legs as he stared down the ominous dirt road, the ground barely visible through the thick white fog. A few leaves blew out from the white fog down the dirt street, and he swallowed. Was that the howl of the wind?
or an animal. Scared, shaking, and barefoot, Pete stepped slowly into the fog. Chapter 3. Mrs. Battisworth's Academy and Home for Unliving Boys and Girls. The fog seemed to clear up moments after Pete passed through, but the unsettling feeling in the pit of his stomach did not ease. The dirt road had a brick wall on either side of it. To the right, the wall was made of brown, rust-coloured bricks. To the left was a short, grey wall that ended after a few paces and gave way to thick woods. Pete shivered as he looked at the woods. It seemed darker outside than it should have been on such a bright early morning, and he could have sworn there was something in those trees watching him. Vines clung on the wall and grew wilder as he walked. About 50 paces later, the brick opened to a beautifully adorned, massive wrought iron gate with the letters B and A woven into the handles. A vine-covered sign to the left welcomed Pete to Mrs. Battisworth's Academy and Home for Unliving Boys and Girls. Pete let out a small gasp as he looked past the gate to the massive green lawn and a looming mansion also covered in vines. It was very beautiful and green and had a fountain trickling water in front of it. He squinted at the fountain. Was it shaped like a giant spider? In spite of the odd fountain, most of his fears melted away as he looked at the building. Something about it felt familiar.
What you staring at?
A voice asked, making Pete jump. He looked around. He was getting tired of being startled.
Hello?
He said, a touch of impatience in his voice. No one was there. He tried the handle. The gate was unlocked, and he pushed it open, cautiously, stepping through. No one was hiding on the other side, either.
That's odd. I didn't say hello,
the voice said again. Higher this time. Without any other warning, a girl popped into view up on the wall, where there had not been a girl before. Pete took an involuntary step backward, staring up at her. She looked pleased by his reaction. He wasn't sure if he was more surprised that she'd appeared out of nowhere, or that she was holding her severed, pigtailed head in her arms. He didn't want to be rude, so he forced his mouth shut and smiled.
How did you get up there?
He looked around. The wall had to be at least a good 8 feet tall. She flipped her head backward between both hands, hair whipping around madly, and stuck it back onto her shoulders with a practiced ease that made Pete nauseous. She grabbed onto a vine and swung down, letting go and free-falling the last 3 feet, until she landed in an expert roll and popped back up a few centimeters from Pete's face.
Why? You asking for a lesson?
Pete said. Finding the air had gone thick as paste. He had an odd feeling in the pit of his stomach.
I'm Scoot,
she said.
What?
Pete blurted out. The girl frowned.
My name is Scoot.
She looked like she wanted to punch him, and suddenly Pete noticed how tall she was. He swallowed hard, regaining his composure.
Sorry, you caught me off guard,
he said formally.
My name is Peter Green.
He held out his hand.
Call me Pete.
Looking surprised, Scoot gripped his hand in a painful shake.
Ew,
he said, wincing with pain.
Would love to have a lesson, but...
He looked back at the school, conflicted. He did think it would be fun to climb the gate. But Pete was starting to be very curious about the school. What had spooked the bus driver so badly? He also wanted to know more about where he was and figure out if there was a way to get his memories.
Maybe a rain check?
He said, finally. She shrugged. Now that his own shock had worn off, he took in more details about her.
Her pigtails were a shade of red that was actually more orange than red. She had a few freckles, but not many. She had a boyish, almost goth look about her, in spite of the pigtails. It was as though she had not decided if she wanted to look like a tomboy, a schoolgirl, or dye her hair black and worship the devil. She eyed his figure doubtfully.
What's with the outfit?
Pete didn't know what to tell her, seeing as he couldn't remember. Anyway, her own outfit was rather interesting too. She was wearing what was clearly a school uniform, but it was obvious she'd made some modifications that reflected her personality. The pleated grey school skirt and grey vest were dressed up with Halloween-themed knee-high socks and dark orange Converse tennis shoes that almost matched her hair. There was a patch sewn onto the breast of her vest that was a crest with a black spider in the centre encircled in white, although it occurred to Pete as he looked back at the spider fountain that it might actually be the school crest. The white shirt under the grey vest was untucked, but had designs drawn on it with a permanent marker. She wore dark eyeliner and lipstick, and looked to be about his age, maybe a little older, around 14 or 15.
Well?
She asked again. He realized he still hadn't answered her question.
Ah.
He shrugged his shoulders. Thankfully, she let it go.
Well, come on. I'll show you the school. You look like a deer in the headlights, you know that. You didn't when you first came here?
Pete spat at her. It wasn't like he just died or anything, and shown up in this strange new world without his parents or friends or anyone he knew, let alone any memory of them.
Fair enough,
Scoot said mildly, surprising Pete because he'd expected her to argue and tell him no way. She'd been totally calm her first day after death. She noticed his reaction and smirked.
You'll get the hang of things quick enough.
Pete doubted it, but followed after her anyway. As they walked toward the school building, Pete recognized what he'd felt in the pit of his stomach when he saw her masterfully maneuvering on the wall. It had been jealousy, pure, raw envy, and it surprised him. He didn't remember anything about his past. But surely it involved climbing a wall or two, didn't it? He really hated not knowing. As they walked to the school, he wasn't sure, but he thought he might be hearing things, scrapes and sniffing sounds. But whenever he looked around, he saw nothing. He thought it had been his uneven breath at first, but when he held his breath for a moment, there it was again, more sniffing and shuffling too. At one point, he swore he heard a whine, but no one was there. After the 9th time, he looked behind him. Scoot noticed what he was doing.
That's bark.
Bark?
Pete said blankly.
What's bark? Bark is the invisible dog. He lives in the school. He will follow you around if he thinks you're up to no good, which I usually am,
she added as an afterthought.
I get followed a lot.
She looked behind her at the empty lawn.
Charlie and I have tried everything to make him visible again, but nothing works. I've been tempted to try and get a professor to help us, but I don't think any will.
Why not?
And who's Charlie?
Scoot shrugged, her long orange pigtails dangling behind her.
Dunno. Not a priority, I guess. And I'm about to introduce you to Charlie in a sec.
Shivers went up Pete's spine when he felt his pant leg move a little and heard sniffing sounds by his leg. The sniffing sounds stopped once they entered the building, and he heard a distant bark somewhere off to their right. Charlie Smith turned out to be a chubby black-haired kid about Pete's age. He sat behind a desk in the administrator's office. He was speaking animatedly to a secretary with cat-eye glasses and long red lacquered nails, who was nodding her head, eyes closed. She had a pen in her hand and was sort of shaking the pen at him.
Absolutely,
the woman said, not acknowledging Pete and Scoot's presence.
You hit it on the head, Charlie. I mean, how is Madison supposed to find love after that?
She's hopeless,
Charlie agreed fervently.
I know we're supposed to love her or something, but please.
He rolled his eyes dramatically.
I mean, I am so over the whole damsel in distress act she's had going on. Are you ladies done talking about your dumb show that doesn't matter?
Scoot asked.
I have a new kid here.
Mrs. Cat-Eyed Glasses stuck her nose up in the air and looked away from Scoot.
Hello, Samantha,
she said haughtily.
Scoot,
Scoot corrected with a scowl.
Welcome to the unorphanage for all us unorphans,
Charlie interrupted what was sure to be an argument.
Thanks. What's an unorphan?
Pete asked.
Not a real thing,
Scoot answered over Charlie.
Stop trying to invent a new word. It's not going to stick.
Charlie ignored her and replied cheerfully.
You know, unliving orphans. But actually, we aren't technically orphans because we died, not our parents.
He waved his hand.
I don't know. Sounded great in my head.
He shrugged, unconcerned.
I'll test it on other subjects before I decide to adopt the phrase.
He turned to Scoot, who rolled her eyes.
That sounds stupid. She thinks everything that is awesome and fabulous is stupid,
he said, unruffled.
No, I think things that are stupid,
she responded. The secretary sniffed loudly, still without looking at them. She held out her hand without looking up. When nothing happened, she finally lifted her eyes to Pete.
Papers,
she said expectantly. He looked at her blankly, before remembering the papers that were given to him what seemed like a lifetime ago.
Oh, my apologies, Mrs.
He looked at her desk.
Dillery?
He handed her the contents of his pockets. She handed him back the map, and he tucked that back into his pajamas.
Quite all right,
she said, much more warmly than before. She began typing.
I'm Charlie,
Charlie said, holding out his hand.
Pleased to make your acquaintance. I'm Pete.
They shook hands. Charlie gave Scoot a grin.
Well, about time we got someone polite. Maybe you'll rub off on Red. Doubt it,
Scoot answered. The secretary sniffed again and tore a page from an old-fashioned printer. She folded and pulled off the edges. She handed the page to Pete.
Here is your schedule. You don't get to pick your elective since it's your first year here. They'll show you around and there are maps on the walls.
Charlie pointed at the map and said,
We'll show you around so you don't have to subject yourself to the unfashionable indignity of looking at a wall map.
Pete chuckled.
Okay, thanks,
he said, looking down at his schedule. On it was written, Peter Green, Hamlet Dorm, 7th year, semester 1. Beneath that there was a table which had 4 vertical columns. Across the top it read hour, course, course name, and location. There was something called A hour, marked as free. Then first hour, umph stroke 101, mathematics for unliving souls in 412N. The second hour, AF stroke 202, History of Afterlife, in 318. The third hour, Finn stroke 107 brackets 1 stroke 2 semester split close brackets, Finn stroke 207, Personal Finance, Banking Systems, 722P. The fourth hour, Tech stroke 103, Introduction to Technology, 019. Fifth hour, Death, stroke 100. Introduction to Death and Afterlife, 012. And finally, the sixth hour, Wood, stroke 101. Woodshop, in 114. Charlie pulled the schedule away from Pete and looked at it.
Ah, we have no classes together.
He sounded disappointed.
But we are both in the same dorms, at least.
There's no sense in taking you to your first hour class, he said, looking at his watch. It's almost over. I'll give you a quick tour and then have someone walk you to your second period class. I know someone in it with you.
Charlie's first hour was working in the admin office.
I'm supposed to be there to help with morning rushes, but mostly we just talk about the unbeating heart, he confessed.
This turned out to be a very dramatic soap opera that involved a captain of a ghost pirate ship, a prison cook, a maid, a duchess, her husband, his mistress, and seven other main characters. Scoot said several times that the show was stupid and that she did not watch it, but proceeded to argue in detail about the characters and the plot anyway. After about 15 minutes of this, while walking, Charlie looked up and announced,
First stop in orientation. Our dorms.
Pete looked up and blinked. They had somehow walked outside into another wing of the mansion in the span of their argument. They went into the dorms, which were large and spacious. The main room of Hamlet was full of cots. Books and bags were stored under the beds. The room had many windows, with thick, long curtains drawn to the side to let the morning light in. Straight ahead was a room that Charlie said led to a small study hall. Charlie pointed out one of the beds with freshly folded sheets and a clean uniform lying on it.
This is yours, he said with a smile. Pretty close to mine, he said, plopping down and grabbing something under his cart.
Scoot leaned against the wall, looking bored. Pete took the clothes gratefully, and Charlie pointed out the bathrooms, large enough for a dozen people, where he could change to the right of the main room. On the way back, with his crumpled-up pajamas, Pete paused in front of a mirror, fascinated by his own reflection. He hadn't seen himself since he died. He looked at his thin frame of average height, sunken blue eyes, hollow cheeks, and dark chestnut-brown hair. Pete thought he might have looked handsome if he wasn't so thin and pale.
Coming,
Charlie called from the other room.
We are running low on time. Yes.
Pete pulled his eyes away from his reflection. As the orientation continued, Pete could tell that the manor had once belonged to someone very important and wealthy. The library looked as though it might have been a ballroom and stood several stories tall. The hallways had marble floors and statues, carved floorboards and chandeliers. Hidden behind the fashions of displaced boys and girls was evidence of the home's past affluence. He wondered vaguely whose house it might have been. Had it been the home of this Battisworth person who started the school? However, as beautifully as the manor was designed, it was much more confusing. The past owner must have been insane or paranoid, because the house was designed as part maze, part home, and part death trap, no pun intended. There were secret doors and corridors, and according to Charlie, there were also trapdoors that led to dungeons and water pits. Pete and his new friends would start walking on the second floor and somehow end up on the fourth floor without walking up any steps. There was even a hallway that was a maze of mirrors. They tried to walk through two separate times, but kept ending up back in the entrance of the hallway.
We never get through here, Charlie admitted. We try every day, but it never works.
Pete looked at Scoot, who was now holding a knife. Alarmed, he stepped backward and exclaimed,
Where did that knife come from?
He looked first at her short, thin, pleated skirt, then at her shirt with no pockets, and her socks that could not have hidden so much as a tiny spoon, much less a knife the size of her arm.
Don't worry about it,
she said, glaring at the entrance to the mirrored hallway.
You can't knife the mirrors again, Charlie said, in a bored voice. We have to go to town this week. I need a new scarf, and you wanted brass knuckles, remember?
Scoot turned her glare on him.
The bat said if you got detention again, you wouldn't go into town this month,
Charlie continued.
You really want to wait another month for those?
She dropped her hand and sighed. Pete eyed her closely to see where she would hide the knife, but he got distracted when he noticed a little girl in the mirror's reflection, about 9 or 10, with shoulder-length brown hair and big round brown eyes, looking back at him. He turned, but she had vanished. He looked back at the mirror, wondering if the light was playing tricks on him, but nothing. He was about to shrug it off when he heard a hissing, a slurp, and the sound of something being dragged across the floor. The mirrors closest to them showed something large and terrifying behind him. Pete turned around, gasped, and stumbled backward. In front of him, at least 9 feet tall, was something with a female humanoid-like shape. She had a neck that was at least 3 feet long, hunched so as not to hit the ceiling. She was scaled and had claws and long teeth that hung out of her shriveled mouth. She hissed again and dragged her back leg across the floor. Her clawed hands gripped a stick, and she seemed to be slowly moving towards them, her mass blocking the exit. His new friends didn't seem to have noticed the monster. Pete's breath was ragged as he turned and grabbed them.
"We have to run!"
he shouted, interrupting an argument that had erupted about a mandatory accessories policy that Charlie had proposed. Together, they ran into the hallway full of mirrors at top speed.
"What is it?"
Charlie asked, breathless.
"Just run!"
Pete shouted. They ran forward and around a mirror, dodged a long one that made them look both fat and skinny, jumped around one hanging at an angle, under two mirrors that created a tunnel, finally sliding down a short slide made of mirrors and ducking under a low hanging mirror. And ended up exactly where they started.
What?
Pete was completely flabbergasted.
How?
He had been baffled before, when his new friends were the ones leading him through. But he thought they might have been purposefully leading him in a confusing, disorientating circle. This time, when he ran through it, he had definitely felt like he had been running forward. How in the devil had he ended up where he started? Charlie was wheezing.
"I can't believe I just ran,"
he said, truly in shock.
"How are we going to get away from it?"
Pete asked in a panic. The monster had moved 2 feet closer. Scoot, noticing the creature for the first time, relaxed her shoulders and said,
"Oh, that's Mrs. Warshaw, the janitor. She's not allowed to eat the school kids anymore."
Pete looked at Scoot, thinking she must be joking. But she had a straight face.
"Did you see that?"
Charlie wheezed.
"Yes, see, I was there, I saw you run."
"Dang, I'll have to tell Patty Malikowitz. You'll have to back me. You know she won't believe me."
As they walked down the hall toward the monster, and Charlie and Scoot chatted about Sally Howarth's new haircut, Pete was having a furious internal debate. He wanted to simultaneously scream, run away and cry, and also somehow impress his new friends. As a means to try and distract himself, he looked around to see if he happened to see the little girl he'd caught in the mirrors earlier, wanting to focus on anything but Mrs. Warshaw. He paused for a moment, suddenly aware of how rude his actions must have appeared. He suspected that this Mrs. Warshaw had noticed him yell, run away, and call her a monster. He did not know how a woman of her caliber would react to such rudeness. Pete started walking again, but when he drew even with Mrs. Warshaw, he stopped in front of her. He straightened, holding his breath to keep from shaking, looked up at her face, and said,
"Hello."
Charlie and Scoot stopped talking and looked behind them.
"My name is..."
he faltered, as her 3-foot-long neck lowered her head to hover just in front of his face. Her large eyeballs protruded out of the side of her head, and her eyelids came up every 30 seconds or so to close over the large, dark, slitted pupils of her eyes.
My name is Pete, he said, in a small, weak voice. It's nice to meet you, Mrs. Warshaw.
He ended in almost a whisper. Her teeth gleamed in the dim lighting, and she hissed quietly. He said, not quite sure if the hiss was friendly or not.
I'll let you get back to work.
Then he added,
I just wanted to say hi.
He slowly walked away and was very aware that her head followed just beside him until she could no longer reach.
Wow, said Charlie when they were out of earshot. I have never seen her smile before.
That was a smile?
Pete said weakly. He was still shaking from the encounter. The rest of what Scoot called orientation was filled with equally terrifying experiences. There was a giant snake just lounging on the 6th-floor bathroom.
We'll have to go in another one,
Scoot said.
He doesn't look like he's in a good mood.
There was a human-shaped lump in its massive body. They scurried out of there and continued with the tour. When Pete glanced through a beautiful window the size of a large automobile, he saw a wolf sleeping on a wooden bench outside. In the cafeteria, the workers had scaly skin, except for one who looked like someone had stuffed an octopus into a uniform. As they were walking past the cafeteria, the octopus screamed and leapt onto one of her colleagues, and they started fighting. Pete swore he could hear bats inside some of the walls of the manor. Things that he thought were mere shadows would get up and walk away, leaving the area sunny in their wake. It was positively disconcerting, yet Scoot and Charlie acted like none of it was any big deal. They ended the tour at the bookstore, where instead of an attendant greeting them behind a cash register, books were deposited from a slot, as something growled loudly from an adjacent room, rumbling the walls.
Honestly, I can never understand what she's saying, Charlie said, as he picked up disheveled books and handed them to Pete. That's a she?
Pete asked, with a gulp. When they made their way out to the back of the school, Pete learned that the playground had been replaced with a maze made out of hedges, and was the largest and most elaborate in all of Afterlife.
Why?
Pete asked.
Why not?
Scoot responded. Orientation ended when the bell rang, and the kids piled into the hallways. Charlie and Pete pushed past everyone until they met a tall kid with shaggy brownish blonde hair, tan, freckled skin, and light eyes.
Brody, Pete, Pete, Brody,
Charlie said. He turned to Pete and said, pointing at Brody,
he has his next class with you, so he can walk you. I'll catch up with you before lunch.
Pete waved his goodbyes to Scoot and Charlie, and Brody said,
I'm 14 DA. How old are you?
They made their way down the confusing corridors towards their history class.
DA?
Pete asked, looking up. Brody looked over and shook his head.
Sorry, I forgot. It's slang for death age, I think. Whatever. It's like how old you were when you died, plus the time you've been here.
Oh, I'm 14 too. How long have you been here?
About a year. It's pretty cool here. Well, most of it is,
Brody said.
Do you remember anything?
Pete asked. Brody shook his head and shrugged.
No, not much.
Pete rubbed his temple, annoyed.
I feel like I'm forgetting something important. It's making me mental.
Brody nodded knowingly.
That'll go away pretty quick.
So we'll never get our memories back?
Pete asked. He didn't like this blankness in his mind.
Oh, no, of course we will. We pick up our memory files when we graduate from here.
Memory files?
Pete's brow furrowed.
But why? Why not give them to us now?
Brody shrugged.
Dunno, they explained it in one of my classes, but I forget the details. Something about the magic here, making people crazy.
Pete frowned dubiously.
Where is here, exactly? He asked, happy to be finally getting some answers. I mean, I know we're in purgatory, but where is that, exactly?
Brody tilted his head side to side as he walked, contemplating.
So, really, I need to pay more attention in class, he admitted. But from what I get, afterlife is kind of the big place, the universe, and purgatory is just one place inside of it.
But why am I here? Why did we come here?
Pete amended. Brody shrugged again.
There aren't too many orphanages. I think this is the biggest one, so I must come here. Glad I did, though. It's pretty cool here. So, how did you die?
He asked, curiously. They stopped walking to join a line outside of a classroom with the number 318 next to it. Pete frowned deeper.
I don't know. Am I supposed to know that?
Brody shook his head.
Oh, nah, not till graduation, like I said.
He waved his hand airily.
You know, but some of us can guess.
He squinted, seemingly holding his breath, and his face changed to show a large burn on the side of it. He shrugged.
My powers of deduction says I was in a fire of some sort. What about you?
Pete shook his head, looking himself over.
I'll double-check later, but I haven't found anything yet. I bet I died in a stupid way,
he added dejectedly.
No matter. I mean, yeah, I get to have a cool burn on my face, but that's pretty rare. Most people don't have bullet holes or arms that disappear. Most people just look like you do. No problem. I was just curious.
Brody gave a friendly smile, but looked a little too happy for the situation. Several of the girls next to him smiled and waved. Pete noticed Brody didn't change his face back to hide his scar.
Who is the bat everyone keeps mentioning?
Pete asked, guessing who that might be, but asking anyway. Brody's smile faltered and Pete shivered instinctively.
Oh, she's the headmistress of the school. You'll meet her. She meets all the new students.
Chapter 4. The Harvest Moon. Brody's prediction came true later that same day. Pete was in good spirits as he made his way to lunch. His orientation may have been terrifying, but his classes so far felt closer to what he had been expecting. He was happy to find out that the school semester had barely started. He was really only a couple of weeks behind everyone else. There was a lot to learn, and much of it only led to even more questions, but the subjects were interesting, and, except for one scare in which he thought his 700-year-old vampire instructor, who could incidentally pass as a beautiful, short, blonde 16-year-old heiress with sunken dark eyes and hollow cheeks, was going to eat him, everyone was pretty nice to him. Maybe death wouldn't be so bad after all. Charlie met him after third period and took Pete on a roundabout way to the cafeteria.
Just need to grab something, really quick, he said.
As they were walking, however, Charlie suddenly paused, looking worried.
Oh, no. What's wrong?
Pete asked, then started noticing what Charlie was seeing in the hallway ahead of them.
Why is there fog inside? We should go back,
Charlie said, grabbing Pete's arm. But before he could make another move, the door to their left slammed open. A gust of thick fog flowed freely out of the room beyond, which looked like a dungeon. In the doorframe stood a towering 7 or 8 foot tall, rail-thin woman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.